Shut up and sit down.
Welcome to the Literary License Podcast 2-for-1 episodes, where we look at two films and discuss the themes of the month with your special co-host, Vicky Ray, John Wilson, and Keith Shago, coming at you from the UK and USA.
Hello, welcome to Literary License Podcast, and today we're discussing Hard Candy from 2005 and Ex Machina from 2014. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us. And today I have Vicky Ray. Hello, Vicky.
Hey, guys.
Hello, Jesse Foltz.
How's it going, folks?
And John Wilson. Hello, John.
Howdy, y'all.
Hey there.
And before we get started, let's go into our Roses and Thorns segment. So, Jesse, what's your Roses and Thorns of the week?
The weather's great for my rose. It's fantastic. The roses are blooming, and my thorn, people can't get along. There we go. That's all I'll say.
And what about yourself, John? Any roses and thorns for the week?
No, there's too many thorns already in the world, so I think I'd rather not talk or add to any thorns. Roses, I actually finished watching Unorthodox, which I thought was really good. Brilliant. It was a great series, and it's done. It's on Netflix, only four or five episodes. It's really, really intriguing and interesting.
Is it a one season deal?
Yeah, it's a one season. It's actually someone's story. It was based off of a book that was written, and it's just sort of telling of that.
I've not heard of it.
Yeah,
it's really very good. I watch it. It's very easy to read. What I like about it is that the situation that she's in, there's no evil person in it.
Yeah.
Which I quite liked.
Yeah. It's just based on, you know, different cultures converging, and there's no, like Keith said, there's no bad guy. There's no malicious intent. There's no, it's just, you know, two different cultures converging, and, you know, it's a couple that gets that's divided, right? And it's systematically, you would say, oh, well, this is where, you know, these people should be together because of, for this reason. But it's really someone who wants to explore a different world and another universe wanting to pull her back into that world.
Sounds interesting. I'll have to look it up.
Yeah. Excellent. And what about yourself, Vicky?
I don't have too many thorns because like John said, there's just, we all know what our thorns are and we're all sick of the negative. But I did watch a couple of messed up movies though. I gotta stop watching The Last Drive-In.
Oh God. Oh yeah. Yeah.
I watched this other one last night called Brain Damage. I just could not get enough of it. I don't know if y'all seen it, but the little squiggly guy that attaches himself to the back of your head.
Jeffrey Coombs film.
Yeah, so, I can't.
Stuart Gordon, who did Reanimator.
Yeah, I can't explain it, but it's funny as hell, but it's sickeningly good. So if you guys watch The Last Drive-In with Joe Bob Briggs, it's actually very good. I think it's in his first season. And I watched it. I thought I was like zoned out on zombie movies. But then I watched this little gem from Korea called The Train to Busan.
Oh, I love Train to Busan.
I could not stop watching it. That had to be one of the best zombie movies I have ever seen in my entire life.
Well, guess what? There's a sequel coming called Peninsula. And that's actually coming.
Was so good. And I mean, the effects was great. The story was great. Who gives a shit if you had subtitles? The action was so great. You didn't even pay attention to the subtitles. You knew what was going on. It was a fantastic film. I can't wait if they're making a second one. Oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah. The trailer just came out. So you should check it out. It's really good. Yeah.
My rose and thorn. My roses has to be Little Fires Everywhere with Reese Witherspoon, Joshua Jackson, and Kerry Washington. Excellent series. It's available at Amazon Prime. And started watching that. And I think another one I'm quite enjoying is Devs, written by Alex Garland, who actually wrote Mechano that we're covering today, Ex Machina, and he wrote The Beach and one of the most seminal books of the 90s was The Beach. So it's very good. He actually directed and wrote this. So I'm quite enjoying that. My thorn has to be mothers who are all geared up in the freaking mask and the gloves and their children who are not wearing anything and they're crawling all over everything.
God, I know.
Yeah, I know.
I see that too. And I'm like, do you just don't care about your kids? Are you just like trying to limit the household? You want to like eliminate?
Precisely.
And people say kids are unaffected. I think that's why that happens.
Well, they're not unaffected. And the only thing, before we had the menopause moms, which were pretty bad with the stick going, so that's the thing is they're pointing the stick at you. I mean, the only thing I want to do is lick their face is to get them off my back. and then you have this other group of moms coming up, like these young moms are all like, they're protecting themselves, but then you got the kids crawling all over you. It's like you're on the tube and they're like sitting next to you and it's like, I go, can you move your sprog? I'm sorry. I just don't want your ugly child in my face, and they get really upset. So anyway, that's my thorn. It's like, come on, you know.
Just get like do like what you would do for a cat or a dog. Just get a spray bottle and just
get a squirt gun.
Squirt them in
put
the face.
Them on a frick. They put children on a freaking leash. My mom put us on a leash, and then she used to tie us to the clothesline, and we used to run up and down the clothesline. We had these like little halter things.
But you have and a dog been, run?
Oh,
your
no.
mother put you on a dog run.
Yeah,
how does it make you feel?
It was fine. We had a good time. I mean, every once in a while we get tangled up in each other, and she had to come out and untangle us. We were fine.
That explains so much.
Market. She's
yeah.
It's basically like. What's it called? Like a harness. It's like a harness that they wear and it has like a little thing in the back. And then when she'd take us to the supermarket, she would put us on this harness and then go there. So that way we can wander off.
What kind of child were you?
I was going to say.
Well, today I'd be considered an abused child. Back then I was considered the norm. So who knows? So, well, that brings us to Story Geek. Now, Story Geek's segment is about what you can download and what you can watch for free from the comfort of your own home during the COVID-19. So take it away, Story Geek.
What movies and TV shows should you be watching the week of June 8th? I'm Jay Shear, executive producer of the Story Geeks podcast, and here are the movies and TV shows you can watch from home. Available for rent this week, The Hunt is the only movie that was in wide release right before the pandemic shut down theaters. It's about people being hunted by other people. It's a horror movie, and it had a ton of controversy surrounding it because it was originally supposed to come out at a time that school shootings were hitting the news cycle. The Hunt has a 50 on Metacritic. On streaming, we'll head over to Netflix. Nothing particularly interesting hitting Netflix this week other than what I already talked about on last week's segment. Over on Amazon Prime, it's pretty much the same thing. All the new content came out June 1st, and I've already mentioned a lot of those things briefly in previous segments. Disney Plus does have some new content. Some National Geographic shows appeared this week. I have seen Wild Hawaii because I love Hawaii, and it was great, worth the watch if you appreciate the Hawaiian Islands. I also have heard that Artemis Fowl is supposed to come out on Friday, June 12th, but the early reviews suggest that it's almost unwatchable, so be warned on that one. Over on Hulu, there's a Bachelor miniseries that's new. Of course, I don't really watch The Bachelor, but if you do, you might want to check that out. And since we didn't have much in the way of new content, I thought I'd give you a couple of personal recommendations in the realm of comedy this week. For adults, I highly recommend you check out Swartz and Middleditch. It's an improv performance. Ben Swartz played Jean Ralphio in Parks and Rec, and Middleditch starred in HBO's comedy Silicon Valley. Both those shows are some of my personal favorites. And this improv show does not disappoint. It is on Netflix, and it is hilarious. For our kid-friendly comedy action mashup, we're going all the way back to 1987. The Princess Bride is a cult classic, and if you haven't seen it in a while, it's definitely worth watching again. The Princess Bride is over on Disney Plus. And then if you want some of my honorable mentions for comedy, if you want to laugh this weekend, I think we could all use a little bit of a laugh. I recommend Tom Papa's stand-up special, You're Doing Great, which is really funny. That's on Netflix. The Wrong Missy is sort of a mess in terms of storytelling, but it made me laugh. I'm a David Spade fan. That's also on Netflix. The Lovebirds, also on Netflix. I'll be honest, I laughed a lot at this film. I even laughed at it more than I laughed at The Wrong Missy. For some reason on Metacritic, it doesn't have a great user score, but I highly recommend it because I was laughing hysterically throughout. And finally, over on Disney Plus, I highly recommend the reboot of the TV show The Muppets from a couple years back. People complained about this version of The Muppets being too adult for kids, but apparently they never watched the original TV show of The Muppets back in the day, which was totally made for adults. Anyways, do not miss this show, the reboot. It's laugh out loud funny in just about every episode. It is an off week for the Story Geeks podcast this week, but you can listen to all of our previous episodes by searching for the Story Geeks podcast on your preferred podcast provider. Until next week, this has been Jay Shear, executive producer of the Story Geeks podcast. I hope you have fun streaming movies and TV shows at home.
Hello, welcome back, and thank you, Story Geek, for those wonderful suggestions. I can't wait to watch those. So now what we're going to talk about is our first film, which is called Hard Candy from 2005, which is an American thriller film focusing on a 14-year-old female vigilante's trapping and torture of a man whom she suspects of being a sexual predator. The film was directed by David Slade, written by Brian Nelson, and starred Ellen Page and Patrick Wilson. It was the first feature film for Slade, who has primarily directed music videos. The film premiered at the 2005 Sundance Film Festival and was screened at the Florida Film Festival in April 2006. It had a limited release in two theaters in the U.S. The film made over $7 million at the box office, including almost $6 million from outside the U.S. on a budget of under $1 million. Hard Candy won 3 awards at the 2005 Stiges Film Festival in Spain, 4 awards at the Malaga Film Festival, another one in Spain, and also awarded Overlooked Film of the Year, the 2006 Phoenix Film Critics Society Awards. Page won Best Actress at the 2006 Austin Film Critics Association Awards.
To meet girls over the internet.
Well, I think it's better to meet people online first. Get to know what they're like inside. You work as a photographer, you find out real quick. People's faces lie.
Does my face lie? That is so good. Do you want some?
Sure. You look older than you are, and you certainly act older than you are.
Really?
Wanna call your sister? Tell her where you'll be?
Maybe later. I'm reading Romeo and Juliet. It's a 9th grade book, but I figured I could have it done before the school year starts.
Didn't know you're interested in that kind of thing.
You thought since we've been chatting for 3 weeks that you knew everything about me? We're all shot here?
My house is my studio.
I recognize this girl.
The things you do wrong, they haunt you.
This is officially sick.
I have never hurt anyone!
It's just so easy to blame a kid!
Who are you?
Playtime is over. Now it's time to wake up.
So, John, what are your thoughts of Hard Candy?
I, first of all, Ellen Page is probably the most under, you know, like she is such a great actress. Like she shouldn't have won some type of award for this, like an Academy for this, because she just is so freaking fantastic. She makes you feel
everything
in this movie, like everything, every dialogue that she uses. She also, for her age at that time, she seems or feels older. Like she feels like she's in her 20s. That's how, like, and she's also someone that now she is older. She looks like she's 15. It's like a weird paradox thing that's happening with her as a character.
It's true.
I found one of the interesting things that they mentioned I was reading was how the choice of what they put her in, the red hoodie, how that was like an accident, because like people were actually starting to see that as like a Little Red Riding Hood, which I thought was very fascinating. Like,
I thought when I was watching it, didn't you?
I thought it was intentional, but they didn't do it intentional by any means. So I thought that was really cool. And then also the use of coloring and the use of how they do the cool colors to mellow the scenes and the bright colors to kind of make it more awake and alive. I thought that was such a brilliant thing. And as someone who loves visuals, the tight scenes when you're trying to watch everything and how everything is really tight, like you're not allowed to see what else is going on. Like you're have to be so focused on the particulars of the people that you're viewing. I thought was, it's one of my favorite ways of doing cameraing and angling. I love that.
The film, how they filmed it with the special, you know, the filters.
Yeah.
With the,
ETTs, I think it's
ETTR effects. Yeah, I couldn't remember the name of it, but
yeah,
it didn't do anything to the backdrop, but it centered even on the dark shadowing on them.
Yeah.
But it brought a lot of that, I guess, emotion across, because, I mean, I'm not a guy, but I felt like crossing my legs through at least half of this movie.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, it sort of like trained off to like when she was torturing him, like, you notice how it trained off to the back door a lot.
Yeah.
The curtain was open and I kept expecting a neighbor or somebody's like, you know, it's like no one's
going to. I think they do that on purpose because it builds this form of suspense. Probably that's, you know, I think maybe what they were trying to do, maybe this was intentional or not, but I think that's like where your eyes would go if you were held captive and you know, you'd be thinking and doing all these things. Plus it keeps you focused on him, so that way you don't know what she's doing and you feel that suspense, because it almost feels like most of the movie that he is innocent for the most part and then she's just maybe misinterpreting him or something. At least that's how I felt, and
I was starting to think he was innocent too. Talk about hunting the non-innocent, because they're both guilty of a lot of things. She hunts and he's kind of a weirdo, you know, but at first you don't really, well, does she got the wrong guy after a while, you know?
Well, I mean, yes and no, because like the opening scene is a man talking to a
That's
girl.
True. He was.
It's not like he's after. Not talking to a 20 something and then he shows up and he's like, oh, I didn't realize you're this young. Like, it's not that at all.
True.
You know, this is like to Catch a Predator 2.0. Like basically, you know,
even when he meets her, the first thing he sees, she's got a little bit of chocolate on her lips and he takes it across, you know, he puts his thumb across
that. Yeah, he licks it. So there's not, I don't feel that there's innocence. I think if anything, it was like, it was a degree of, she flips, you know, it's like a mousetrap situation. She flips it on him. And to what degree of punishment is she going to inflict on him? And then, you know, like you said, she's trying to find out for herself, how badly do I want to put this guy through what he's, you know, what he could have done, right? So she needs to verify the extremity of what he's done. Has he photographed girls, or is this his first time? And then she, as she's talking to him, she realizes it's clearly not his first time. He talks about other girls who've come into the studio and being photographed. And so she knows that, but she doesn't know to what extent. And so that's what she's looking for. And then when she finds that, it's like, great, okay, so now I'm going to do this, right? And she's consciously making choices based on how bad of the character he is showing her.
And she's so cool about it, though. I mean, she's so premeditated and calculating with the initial takedown of this guy's sanity after a while. I mean,
but I like the way that they were able to explain why that was, because to be honest, this wasn't her first time at the rodeo.
No.
Yeah.
He got his name by the other person who was actually involved. time as well, which you find out later. So I like the way that they were able to make sense that, like, because you're thinking, like, when you first go into the film, you're thinking, okay, well, this is interesting, and you can't tear your eye away from the sequences because it's very, very tense. And considering there's only two people really in the film outside of Sandra,
that's true. Aside from from Sandra Oh's character,
I had a problem with that character just because.
It's a big
flaw of the film that I had a problem with, which we can get into. It's a fact that, so she studied everything to the fact that she even says to him, oh, I knew you were going to be by yourself. Like, no one's going to hear you. This person's gone. That person's gone. Like, so she had planned this out. Like, she really planned it out. And so the fact that she is seen by her on the roof, and then Sandro comes and confronts her and is questioning her, and then she kind of walks away, and she's trying to get to the point where you realize she's going to get away with it because she's taking all these steps to get away with it. That's a huge flaw. Like, so that's one, and the other one, she bashes her head and she's got blood. So her DNA is fucking everywhere.
Right.
So the whole meticulousness of cleaning everything up, putting everything in place, putting it, like, doing all that. It's like, to me, you had the neighbor who saw you, and then your head is bashed open, and then she doesn't even mention that. Like, oh, honey, what happened to your head? What
exactly? But
hey, are you fine? Like, it's just.
But to be honest, she would actually. I mean, to be honest, if this is real life, I mean, Ellen Page's character would have to actually kill Sandra Oh, really.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Either that, or she get caught. That's or, something about me too. Is that she
I would also say that Sandra Oh is a nosy neighbor, right? So she's the one who comes over. Yeah. So she has to also, you can't tell me that you haven't seen things before. You haven't seen this guy bringing girls to his studio because you are a nosy neighbor. Like, so there wouldn't be this air of, like, more like, who are you? Like, right? And then, oh, you're the niece. Like questioning her that way, it's more, it's like the question she asks her, it's more of like, I'm trying to keep you here to make you uncomfortable. And it's like, to me, just bad writing. Like, it was just like, I'm watching this going, they could have took that.
Well, nothing came of it. That's the thing that was annoying about it, was that nothing came of it. They totally ignored that. I almost wonder if they cut scenes out of it or something, because it makes no sense to have that in there if nothing's going to come of it, if she doesn't get caught or if something else doesn't happen with it. Because
correct.
That's all that they did with her. So it didn't make sense to me.
Well, it's almost like Sandra Oh is available for a day. Let's get her in.
Exactly.
I mean, I thought where they were going to actually go with it, especially where the finale, where it takes place, was her baiting him to try to hurt her, and so she would use Sandra Oh as a way of, like, oh my god, he attacked her, and, you know, I saw, and, like, you know what I mean, like, she had to always kind of course correct when things didn't go the way she wanted them to, and she was very smart and quick to do that. Because she had, you know, she's an honor student. She has this brain to do that.
Here she wasn't, though. She really wasn't.
No. And that's, it was weird. So that's, I was like, it just, that bothered me. It bothered me a lot. And the fact that also, okay, this guy jumps off the roof. And you're right there with the girl, the woman who he's in love with is right there. So you, like, what?
I know.
Like,
it's really weird.
Like, that bothered me. Like, had she been coming down the street, or had she been on her way, she could have got away, and she could have, like, walked away, and it would have been.
Well, she, like, basically does, spoiler alert, get away, kind of, sort of, because she just kind of goes off into the sunset with her little red hoodie after she's, you know, caused all this havoc.
Yeah, I have to sit there and say, though, that if you are going to escape a crime scene, wearing a bright, vibrant color is probably not the best.
And leaving your DNA.
Right, and leaving your DNA everywhere, right? Like,
and she
Well, to be honest, though, she's 13 years old and leaving her DNA around. If Sandra, let's say that you take the Sandra Oh situation out of the film, and she did leave her DNA everywhere, it probably couldn't be traced back to her, because if she is a 13-year-old, her DNA probably wouldn't be on file anywhere.
Right. But what I mean, but
so,
to me,
but she did leave a witness behind, so therefore the DNA would mean.
I just think it would have been more powerful to even, like, you know, still have him kill himself, but then go, and then the police show up and have her be like, oh my god, he did this to me.
I literally thought that's what was gonna happen.
Oh my god, like, I like have like this emotional outburst, and you know everything she did. Like, you're like, well,
yeah, but doesn't that also mean, wouldn't that be a bit weird though, if okay, apparently that he's guilty of you know, being a sexual predator to underage girls. The simple fact that he he sexually molests her, and then he all of a sudden he feels guilty over her. Why would he feel guilty over her? He didn't feel guilty over the other ones.
Because they didn't twerk for him. He's just feeling sorry for himself. I don't think it was that he was feeling guilty. He was feeling guilty because he felt sorry for himself, in that it was kind of like he was being punished for something firsthand by a victim of his. That didn't happen with the other people. They didn't torture him the way she did.
Well, and I also think that
I'm talking about, like, with the police showed. I'm talking about the police showed up. Yeah, and she was there. And said that basically that, he beat me up, da-da-da. And then it's like, well, he committed suicide because he did this to you. He didn't, when he was doing this to other girls, he didn't kill himself. So why, what makes you so special?
Yeah.
Why didn't he kill himself over someone else?
Well, I didn't see, which I thought was brilliant, the fact that she made him hang himself. I didn't see that coming. What I thought was going to happen was the gun and the knife was going to be what killed each other. You know what I mean? Like, she's going to go and just take the gun and maybe, like, throw it or whatever, and it looks like...
Well, I kind of got a hint of that. I thought that was going to happen when she was wrapping the stuff around his face when he had the gun and he was still in the chair, because he had banged her really hard against the wall, and she was, like, in deep pain. I don't know how she could have functioned after that very well, because she could have very well had a fractured rib, but it's not easy to get around a fractured rib.
Yeah. But notice right there, she didn't kill him because she didn't know to what extent. Like, she only wanted to potentially kill him is when she gave him the option to dial 911 and he didn't. And that was her way of saying, fuck you. You wanted to now come after me and try to kill me. Now I'm going to do that. Right. And then the brilliance of it is like, she was always giving him the choice. Like, look, I can make this all go away. I can make it, you know, no one will have to know what you've done. You just have to kill yourself. And I'm like, oh my God, that is pretty brilliant. But then the ending is kind of brilliant when she's like, I lied, or whatever the hell she said. Or not. And I was like,
right after he jumps off.
Oh, yeah.
My mistake.
While he's dying, while he's dying, she's like,
Oh, it wasn't you after all.
Well, apparently she had tortured the other guy before him, because then she's got this Aaron guy's name, and he said that he was the other girl that was raped and murdered, and then the other guy said before he died that he did it. So she already had knowledge of all this transaction anyway, even before she came over there to snip, you know?
There was another, part of it was also too, not that it's important, like the motivation for her, like why. And even like the point to where she's like, you know, oh, you think you're going to come after me? You don't even know who I am. What do you mean? And she's like, do you think I'm going to give you my name? My name's not Haley. Like, I like that, but I also wanted to know, was she related to Donna, right?
What was her story? There was no backstory.
There was a total mystery. It was a total mystery.
Which was, I mean, again, it's fine. It's not necessarily for the driver of the story, but at the same time, she keeps bringing up Donna. Like, Donna, was it your friend? Like, what, you know, like, why?
Yeah, I don't like when they bring up points like that when they don't ever address them. Like, Sandra Oh was one, her relation to Donna, or maybe they weren't, maybe they were related, maybe they weren't, maybe it doesn't matter. I always wondered if she was that little girl that jumped on top of him or something like that, or if they knew each other at some point, but I don't know. It's just kind of confusing.
No, the story with the whole, I think it was his cousin.
That was really disturbing to me.
It was his attempt at empathizing her and trying to get her not to do it.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that she's like, oh, that's so funny. You think I'm not going to do it now? Oh, like, and she, oh God.
I thought she did it. I was like dying.
I know. I don't even have balls.
And I was like dying.
And you hear the sounds of the cutting and the
I was like,
snip.
And she's like, we're almost done. We got one down. I was like,
what was she cutting
she
into?
You never actually figured it out.
No, she was cutting the balls off one by one and then having to suture them and then...
Well, no, she didn't really. It was all
No, she didn't do it.
She cut it.
No, I thought she did.
No.
She had a video. The video that she was showing was a video of it actually happening, but she was actually doing it to him.
When he sat up, when he got free, he goes, oh my God. He goes, I'm okay.
You know? Oh, I thought she did do it to him. I missed that, I guess.
I mean, to be honest, if she was going to fake that whole situation, And a bag of, you wouldn't use a bag of ice. You would actually have to use some kind of lignocaine or something like that to inject. So that way you give her that numb feeling. And all you need to do is kind of give a look, you know, tug around that area, because it would feel like you were touching for him.
Because
it's a bit like, you know, when they give you lignocaine and not see you need stitches.
Yeah.
And basically, and then they stitch you up and it's like, you don't really feel anything, but you do feel the tugging of your skin being closed together. So.
Jesse's all disturbed. If our audience could just see Jesse's face right now.
But I'm saying a bag of ice is not going to give you that same sensation. Because if anyone's ever had an ear pierce using an ice cube, we know what that's like.
Yeah, serious.
Yeah.
It wasn't that bad. But I think that's a very delicate place to be just deciding to go in and cutting things off. But
to be honest, I thought he did quite well with the bag of ice on top of it. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
She kept putting it there too. She was, oh, you're not numb enough. And she just kept putting that bag of ice on his balls.
One of my favorite lines that she, I don't know it verbatim, but it's the line of, I'm that girl. Like, she literally tries to drill in him. You think this is okay. It's not okay. I'm that girl. You know, Don, like, she starts going down this, like, this thing of trying to make him see it's not right. And she, and again, because she's so brilliant, like, she could have very well killed him if she wanted to. She wanted to get through to this man and say, you're fucked up and you're crazy and you know, you did this and, you know.
I really like Patrick Wilson as an actor too. It was so hard.
I know. That's what I was rooting for him the whole time, even though
I think they picked someone who's very charismatic, right? If they picked some like slouch of a guy, you'd be like, yeah, kill him, right? You'd just be like, yeah.
There would be
what
no,
a
there
creep.
Would be no tension. There'd be no tension if you did.
Well, what's quite interesting about the use of Patrick Wilson is that he's a Broadway actor. He just came off of doing Les Miserables. That's where he's from. He starred in that for numbers of years on Broadway. And then he went to that to do Phantom, of course, the movie version of Phantom. So this is like his first dramatic role, not singing. And which would actually lead to a lot of like little children and so on and so forth. If it wasn't for this movie, he probably wouldn't have the dramatic career that he has today.
I think that's true.
Played The Conjuring and stuff like that too, didn't he?
Yeah, The Conjuring. And Insidious and so on and so forth.
Okay, yeah. Because I was wondering, I mean, this was a different role for him because he's always kind of like, he's just such a nice guy. And it's just so hard to watch him as this child molesting, pedophilia laden human being. And I almost felt bad for him when she was making it sound like she was, you know, castrating him. And I was like, oh, this poor bastard, you know, but he was a bad man.
It's like you wouldn't, by the way, you wouldn't feel that way if he had done that to your daughter. You'd be like,
No, I mean, I'm just saying.
You'd be like, cut him out.
As far as a movie goes, I'm saying you know he's a bad man,
the way he is and what he looks like. Again, if he
it's ugly and trolling, and like Ernest Borgnine, chances are you probably
you would have been non-sympathetic I'd be like, here, girl, you hold your hand, I'll hold it for you. Snip, snip.
I just liked how she tortured him. She was really good at that. I mean, she tortured him. I mean, really mentally. Good. I mean, just, can
well,
you
see, that brings me to another point. Sorry to cut you off. But
that's all right, babe.
I almost wonder if they want you to think or wonder if she was like a figment of his imagination, kind of a form of his guilt or something like that. I almost wonder if that's why she's such a mystery, why you don't know anything about her, because then it makes you wonder, was she real? Was she, you know, a figment of his imagination that led to his suicide? Like, what was this? Because there's something very kind of crazy and abrupt about the whole thing, about everything. So you do kind of wonder, because they don't connect ties to the outside world with, you know, who knows this girl? Like, it's all like, she doesn't have parents that seem to care about her whereabouts. I mean, she's gone for hours and hours and hours, and she's either like a ghost or like a figment of his imagination, because she has no ties to the outside world.
Or a true little vigilante.
I mean, she does. I mean, there are scenes when, which again, just shows you her level of like sociopathic like tendencies.
Yeah.
The fact that she is like on the phone, like, hey girl, yeah, you want to go see a movie? Okay. No, yeah, sure. That's fine. And you're like, oh God. You're like, but she does that a couple times. Like she does it where she's just like, she ebbs in and out of that. Right? Like she's let's have a conversation. And then she's like, now I'm going to torture you. And now like she'll like the scene where she's on the computer and she's like, oh my God, I met this really cute boy. Yeah. And she's like, she's basically narrating what she's writing. I'm like, she's crazy. Like she cray cray. Like she knows what she's doing and how she's like.
She's just as disturbed as he is, but only she's out for justice. And like I said, there is mystique. Where does she come from? I mean, she's online clearly, but I mean, is she in these chat rooms to find everybody? Apparently, she did say something about that, though.
Well, she went on with like different personalities and used the same phrasing and find out, and then she kept baiting and using the same phrasing and then using basically, and then we reacted to it. She like, okay, he reacts to this. Then she keep on and see what else he reacted to. And then finally, the last personality that she used, she put all this stuff together because she knew this was the person. And then, so basically she had like, you know, it's basically like if you're going to trap someone on the internet and you're not showing your picture, which is called, you know, basically how catfishing works. Someone's going to do some true catfishing and what they'll do basically is if they're trying to trap someone or grab someone's attention, what they'll do is they'll try a bunch of different ways of communicating. Mm-hmm. And what they'll do basically is they'll go, okay, this works for this person. Okay, now I'm going to go into someone else because I really want to trap this person. So they'll go into someone else and they'll keep going. If the person doesn't respond, but they respond to this, then they go, okay, that's fine. Then eventually they take all that information, make their final person. And then basically they know that person's going to react positively to all this ways. And then you pretty much netted them in.
That's also how she catches him as a pedophile, because he tries to be like, well, oh, I didn't know. That's not my intent. And she was like, really? Because when I created all these other profiles, you didn't want to have any interest with me sexually.
But after they were of a certain age.
Yeah. And then once you're at a certain age and I drop below that, suddenly you're interested. And she like called him out on it. And it was an amazing scene because it's like, she put all that work and effort into it. So, I mean, I think what, to me, the biggest thing is like, if she is so smart, like she guesses the combination of the save, she comes up with this whole way of like making him kill himself. If she's so smart.
Well, she gives him vodka first, the screwdrivers, and drugs him initially to get all this stuff to fall into place though, too.
Yeah. But I mean, she's smart. She's a very smart girl and she knows what she's doing. But then there's flaws. And that's where I'm like, yeah, I don't know.
I mean, to throw the cat among the pigeons here, there is one major flaw of the film. And I do think that Ellen Page playing a 13-year-old is kind of hard to believe, where I think playing if she was 15, I think it gets more believable.
Yeah,
but I understand why they use 13 because 15.
She was 14. 15 is,
she's 13 or 14. Yeah,
she's 13. But the trouble with but she acts like she could be acting like a really intelligent 15-year-old instead of a really intelligent 13-year-old. And I can understand why they would drop her age because 15 to 16 is that weird area where people are kind of sexually awakened, sort of thing. And you get to the point where you know, like in England, for instance, the sexual legal age, okay, if we're going to go back to, you know, Jeffrey Epstein sort of thing and the Prince Andrew story that's going on at the moment. Right. Now, if she was 17 years old and Prince Andrew slept with her in the UK, it's not a problem. That's legal. 16 years old and above is legal.
Right.
But in America, if they slept together in America, it's illegal because it's 18 correct. And above, the age of consent.
Yeah.
But when you get to that 15 to 16 year old, it's a very etchy little, it's a very kind of weird gray area because you got the 15 and 16 year olds who are quite sexually advanced, but then you got the 15 to 16 year olds who are very, very innocent and naive.
Yeah.
So if you drop that down to 13 and 14, so therefore what you have basically is you have, this is definitely wrong situation. There's no room to think, well, sort of thing. So when you drop this down to 13, 14, you know this is definitely wrong, no matter what is going on here.
Yeah.
But if she was 15, if they say they made her look like the way that she was looking and acting as a 15-year-old, then you have this really gray area that would probably help audiences not necessarily condone what he's doing, but for the simple fact that it's a really weird gray area that's really hard to define.
But it's also not as believable because, I mean, I have Hey, I don't even want to bring this up on the same topic, but I have siblings that are that young and they wouldn't be capable of doing something like this physically. Like they wouldn't, you'd have to have not just a knowledge, but like a physical strength to do some of these things to pull them off.
Yeah.
Well, she took a beating, but at the same time, you know, I mean, she took a beating, but at the same time, if she was 2 years younger, the age that she was supposed to be, her beating would have affected her a lot more.
You know, I would also say that we can suspend the disbelief that that was her real age, because again, we don't know what her real name is. So she could have been 17. She could have been 18. She could, like, again, it's, if you look at To Catch a Predator, that's a grown woman playing a child.
Yeah, true. We don't know how old she was. We're just,
So I think you have to kind of suspend the disbelief that she was that age. Cause I think she, for the way she was doing
things.
Good
point, John. Good point.
She had to have had some sort of, and I mean, here's a theory too, is like, if she was doing the things that she was doing, is it like sort of a bit of her prowess of being an honor student and being so smart and clever that you would pick open or open a news article and say, I'm going to figure out what happened to this girl and do the research. Like, it's part of her need or drive to be like, this vigilante is, could also lead her to be a serial killer, right? Because she's doing the justice.
A little bit
for the
of
people.
Both, though, don't you think? Serial killer slash vigilante.
Yeah.
I mean, another thing is you have to remember we are being dropped in the middle of a story here.
True.
To be honest, how she got all the facts and figures about how she got him, we're not really quite sure what happened to the first guy.
Correct. Yeah. Correct.
So therefore, we're kind of dropped in the middle of a story. It's a bit like being dropped into
it. Don't you think, Keith?
No, he is dead. The guy is dead, but it'd be interesting to see what happened there. Like, was she so level-headed, right? So she could have been a little more clumsier there, but she learned from those mistakes, and so the next time around she was much more clever in how she approached.
Well, it's like a psychopathic killer anyway. If you ever know any serial killers and stuff, you know that the first murder that they perform or the thing is very, very messy. And as they go on, they learn and they get better and better. Yes. Like anything,
from,
you know, it's a bit like it is work experience at the end of the day, isn't it? It's like anything that you do, the first time you do any kind of job, you're a bit messy, but by the time you know, do that job in a bit within 2 months, and you pretty much worked all the kinks out, haven't you?
This is true.
Well, isn't that, by the way, sort of Silence of the Lamb, when we reviewed that, that's how they caught the person who was doing it, because it was the first murder that was a sloppy one. That is,
and
how
so it's always close by. And,
Well, that's something that I liked about this movie, actually. And that I kind of miss about horror and thrillers just in general is that they drop you right in the middle of the story. So you're kind of just trying to figure out stuff as you go along. And that's what naturally creates your sense of like, okay, what's going on? You know, who's interacting? What's going to happen with these people? You know, there's not a lot of exposition. People aren't constantly, like the characters aren't explaining to you, like, this is what's going on. This is what's going on. So it's completely, it's all mystery. It's all, you know, there's this tension that's built that you wouldn't have if they hadn't done that, if they had explained things to you, if they had foreshadowed a lot, which they foreshadowed like just a tiny bits here and there, but not enough to really let you know what was going on. Because in the beginning, I remember they did foreshadow about that missing girl. And I honestly thought they were foreshadowing what was going to happen to her, which I'm pretty
sure.
I thought that was a deliberate manipulation. So you would think that. So that way, when the surprise came, when the script was kind of flipped and she was the one that caught him, then it was going to be a total like, wait, what? Kind of moment. Uh-huh.
That's exactly what I thought. I thought she was going to be the one in trouble and she was going to have to break through.
Yeah.
I had not seen this coming at all in this movie.
No. And I thought that she was going to turn out to be like some FBI agent, something justifiable. I wanted some reason to like root for this girl, because obviously he was, you know, a molester, but at some point in the movie, you kind of forget that, because the first encounter is obviously, okay, this dude, there's something wrong with this dude. Yeah. But then most of the movie, you're under the impression that it might be his first time. So you're coming at it from a perspective like, okay, how would I feel in this situation? Like, if he really was a predator, if this was his first time, but he didn't really successfully go through with it, he still has hope or can get help or whatever. But then later on at the very end, you learn that he's actually been a part of watching a girl be brutalized and murdered at the very end. So it's like, oh my, wow.
Yeah, so he definitely had.
But by the way, you still don't know.
For rooting.
Yeah, but you still don't know whether or not who killed the girl, right?
That's because true.
He says he did it. He says he did it. So it's like, we don't know whatever.
To be honest, they're probably both guilty.
Yeah.
Really.
I have a tendency to believe him when he says that he watched the dude, because, I mean, he probably knew who the guy was, and if they were the
two. But the problem basically with that is that he has a lot of female, young age female pictures and stuff like this.
Yeah.
So obviously, though, that pedophilia is his sexuality. It's what he's into.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what he likes. And obviously that he might have not have killed her, but he probably did partake with her sexually.
Probably. Well, something that I was wondering, it's almost like he wasn't really interested just sexually. It almost as if he wanted to have a relationship with a younger person, not just a sexual experience, because he seemed very interested in getting to know her. He took the time to get to know what she was into. He wanted to impress her.
But that's part of grooming. As far as pedophilia is, first of all, pedophilia is a sexuality.
Yeah.
No cure for it. It is what you're into. And when I say true pedophilia is basically when you are attracted to someone before they hit puberty, because before a person hits puberty, they have a certain smell about them, and that's part of the sexual attraction.
Okay, I don't want to know.
But at the same time, what you do basically is what a pedophile will do, and this is a pedophile, there's not one that takes them off the street and has sex with them and murders them, puts them in a cornfield somewhere. These are true pedophilia sort of thing, the normal run-of-the-mill suburban ones. What they do is they find interest and sort of thing. Like, if I was going to be a pedophiliac, I guess I was going to draw people in. I'd be like, oh, I like Xbox games. You like Xbox games? Oh, what do you think about this game? And you would draw them in slowly but surely and work on their same wavelength sort of thing as you're drawing them into your web. Because the thing is, you want to make them think that you're as hip and you're with it as they are. Because then they go, God, this older person is so cool. We've got so much in common. And as you're drawing them in, saying all the stuff, whether it's music, film, television,
Coldplay.
There's
hopefully they brought Coldplay into that.
By the way, there's this great scene too at the beginning when she's like, she basically calls him dad or a father, and she's like, oh my God, no, not. And then she's like apologizing because she wants to reassert that she doesn't think of him that way, but and then she pulls the whole jealousy thing. What are you jealous? Are you jealous of the guy who was hitting on me? And it's like a play of like, you know, that it's not like he could go the route of, oh, well, what are you wearing? She's the one who's doing that to angst him, to get him to cross that line.
But at the same time, they do play that sort of thing, because when you got someone that young sort of thing, and it is a cat and mouse game that the two play together. But the story at the end of the day is, just because they're playing back and they're flirting with you doesn't make it right that you take advantage of that if they're at such a young age.
Correct.
Exactly. That's why when things hit the news and they hit social media, so on and so forth, that's why there tend to be a bit of a tug of war here about, well, you know, I guess if you take Jeffrey Epstein or our Kelly situations, for instance, and they're going, well, the girls were there because they wanted a recording contract while he's taking them around and stuff like this. And the thing is, and then you have to ask, and then what a lot of people will say, well, why did they put themselves in this situation? Well, he's offering them money, so on and so forth.
Yeah. Banks, well, it's also they're too young to know better. Like, right, as you get older, you know when something's not.
Even then, you might not know better. So I know some women that don't.
Correct. No, but I'm just saying, like, when you're young, the ability to see reasoning is not there. You're still learning about life. You're still learning about
all these things. Exactly. You have no idea what you're getting.
No clue.
Yeah. Well, people
you might think it's innocent. You might actually say,
if you're in an age, it's up to you to be the responsible adult, though, isn't it? That's what the whole thing's about.
Correct. Sort of. Yes.
But what's the difference between a 17 and an 18-year-old girl? Just because she's 18, do you think she knows what she's doing? Because she just turned 18? So, you know.
No, the thing is I think when you get between the ages of 16 to 18, I think what you need to do is that you need to look at the person themselves. I think you have to look at personality types, and a lot of things rest on this. You have to look at things like, you know, how mature are they? There are some fairly advanced, mature women, girl, boys, between the 16 and 18, and there are people between the age of 16 who are extremely naive and don't know a lot about the world. So I think that's where this, you know, between you know, 16 and 18 is this huge gray area about, did they know what they were doing and were they accepting about what was happening to them? And did they know what the outcome would be? And did they know what the end game was?
Yeah.
And some people do, some people don't. And that's why this, that's why when you get to that area there, that's why there's this very kind of fishy idea about exactly, you know, how mature was she? How mature wouldn't she know? How, you know, and all the whole thing that's going on there. And yes, okay, let's be honest. I mean, a 40-year-old going out with a 20-year-old, there is something sort of thing. But at the same time, you know,
but I wish.
But sometimes 18-year-olds are really, you know, like the older man sort of thing. Yeah. Does that make so? Does, you know,
there's a level of consensual in that sense. Like, precisely. You're old and enough to be consensual. That's the difference, right?
You precisely. Know? And then if something happens and it's not, you know, it's kind of hard to prove what's consensual and what isn't. That's the problem when you get to that
age. I also say with this movie, what if it didn't go the route? What would that story be, right? So what if she wasn't the one who was doing what he was doing to, you know, she was doing to him? What if he was this predator? Would the story have ended the same way Donna's story ended, right? So it's a very interesting film that way. Like, if you look at it, like,
for 1 minute, maybe she wasn't going to get away with it and he was going to kill her.
I did think a point when basically when the Sandra Oh character shows up, I think they threw her in to knock her off her pedestal, right? Like, she, up until that point, she was so precisioned in what she was doing, and they had to put something, a distraction in her, in place to kind of throw her off a little bit.
I think they also had to add a little bit of tension and for her as well.
Yeah.
Because at the moment, she had all the cards, so they need to throw in, like, a wild card in there, so therefore it knocks her slightly off her game.
But it also alludes to the fact that when... Because right after that scene is when he gets away or he gets out or he chokes her, basically, right? But all of that was staged, like her running around, hiding, waiting for him to get down, to go out, to grabbing the rope, pulling it down. Like, so everything was staged. So it's like in her mind, she knew, she was predicting what he was going to do.
Pretty premeditated, so, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
everything.
Even to the fact that she puts the paintings back up on the wall and he starts stabbing
them. He cleans everything with Clorox too.
No, but he starts stabbing the painting. So maybe she predictably said it makes him look crazy. And now he's stabbing everything and breaking everything, you know, and yeah, I think that her getting away with it was where I think it's a little unbelievable, because I think, unless the detectives or police show up and they see what it is and just overlook everything. Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. That guy's dead. He was a pedophile. He was a sick man. I'm not even going to figure out. Maybe someone killed him. Oh, well, I don't give a, I don't care.
She left all that stuff on the computer and all the information to work.
Well, no. Yeah. Yeah. So my feeling is she did it because she probably thought police officers are going to overlook it anyways, because he was a sick man who deserved to die. Right. And so a police officer would go, well, he killed himself. Oh, well. And then someone might say, but did he though? This looks a little weird. Like, right. There's stuff that happened and they could just simply go.
The only thing they could really get him on is being a pedophilia. There's probably, as far as the actual murder is concerned, if there's no body or something like that, it's going to be really hard to pin a murder on him. Though they could pin pedophilia on, and to be honest, a pedophilia probably spends the most time in jail, probably like 2 to 3 years at the most.
No, but we're even saying her. Like, so imagine the police, like her DNA that's in the home, it could be overlooked, right? Because
when you walk in, she cleaned up after herself with Clorox, you know?
Yeah, but she bled. I mean, she had her head was never bandaged. Yeah. Her head was gashed open, and there was tussles between the two of them, so her DNA has to be underneath his finger.
And Ellen Page was leaving her lesbian skin flakes everywhere.
Oh, and she took a shower. Or did she take a shower? Did she take a shower or no?
No, she didn't. She pretended to because she knew that he was going to come after her.
That's right.
She was really good at knowing exactly what his next move was going to be.
Yeah.
A little too well, though, sometimes. Like, there was not once that she slipped up, and even as intelligent as she was, because she was, you know, so young, I kind of wonder if some of the mistakes were meant to be, like, oh, she's 16, or she's young, so these are her mistakes or something like that, just to make it seem a little more believable. But again, with the Sandra Oh thing, it still doesn't really make sense. And just because she saw her, it makes it less believable that she would have completely gotten away with it.
I'm going to kind of go with John's theory. I mean, is she really 13, 14, or is she like 17 or 18?
And just- I personally think she's older, and I think she portrays to be younger to get these victims, I mean, to get these guys.
She's a vigilante. She's too young to know all
Yeah.
I have to agree with John's theory as well, because there are things where she does like the naive, like when she first meets him and does 13-year act. And then when she becomes the... You know, then once she catches him in the trap and she's got him there, then all of a sudden it's like her demeanor and her vocabulary, everything changes.
Oh, and wait, let's not forget the phone call when she calls Janelle. Oh, hi, this is Detective So-and-so. Yeah. Hi, yes, we need you. And everything she is saying, the verbiage she's saying is something an adult would say, not a child would say. She was very meticulous in how...
I literally thought she was an agent. You know, I thought that she
I thought that too, yeah.
I almost hoped she would have been, because it would have made it a little more satisfying for her character to have the victory. I was almost mad that that wasn't the case, just because I didn't like her... I mean, I liked Ellen Page's acting, but I didn't like that character at all. I wasn't rooting for her, and I felt bad for not rooting for her, because she was after an awful person who was doing bad things. But because she was so psychotic and crazy, and not because she was an agent knowing exactly what she was doing, and maybe a vigilante instead, just makes her look like a psycho killer. And you don't know if she would have that restraint for, you know, a regular...
Well, she doesn't actually kill him, though.
Yeah, she doesn't kill him, no. That's I mean, I think she is quite, I think she's quite brilliant in the sense that she could have, because part of me was like, let's see how crazy this woman is, because my thought was, does she get this woman to come there just to torture her to get him to confess? Because my mind was like, why is she calling this woman? Please don't tell me she's going to torture this woman. I was like, oh my God, don't. And then when I realized what it is, I'm like, she's not a bad person. She's just trying to make someone come to terms with how bad they were. That's the way I saw it. I don't think she's
my problem. My problem actually with this movie is the girlfriend.
Yes. Yeah.
Because it doesn't make a lot of sense. If he is a true pedophile, why was he so hell-bent on this lost love of his? Because this person wouldn't be his lost love. Now, if something happens, he called like it was their sister or his parents.
Or his cousin.
Yes, cousin.
Or remember, his cousin, because she's the one who was like, ah, you know, like, let's not forget that. Like, she started it all, you know.
But to be honest, I think to have that response from him would have been a bit more satisfying. Because you're kind of thinking like, well, basically, it's like if he's a true pedophile, then basically as far as him having a relationship, that he would care about someone like that, the true love of his that got away, probably wouldn't be of age.
Yeah.
So that's
not necessarily true, though, because there have been like actors who have, you know, families and have been also involved with younger people who are married and all of this other stuff. So that I wouldn't say that that's necessarily true. And if it is like a sexuality, well, there are also gay men and gay women who marry straight people and then end up not having a relationship after that.
Yeah, but would you kill yourself over having that person know about your secret?
Correct. No.
I think that I would sit there and say that if it was your family, if you're doing something so atrocious, I think that you probably, like if something happened, let's say let's sit there and say I was luring children to my home and having sex with them and da 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 da.
I had this ex that
ran off into the ethers for whatever reason. If I knew my parents were going to come to my house and find everything, I'd probably be more turned to kill myself than that ex that I broke up with years ago.
Yeah.
Sort of thing.
For anyone to find out.
Stop a little
bitch. So. But, you know, say thing. But at the end of the day, I mean, his guilt, I mean, to be honest, he basically killed himself because he didn't want to go to prison for what he did. And he didn't want people to know. I mean, basically, and the whole thing, I'll kill myself. So therefore, I won't go to prison. So therefore, I won't get gang raped or whatever he thinks is going to happen to him in this prison. And at the same time, in that you can clear everything up. So therefore, I will die with this lovely name over me that I was just a person who was depressed and hung myself. That's what
correct. Or the girl that I love would see
what he did.
Yeah. Or the girl that I love would see me as this martyr or tortured person, right? You know?
Yeah, precisely. I mean, why he would believe that she would actually clean up everything anyway is beyond me, but...
I know. He was literally being tricked. He seemed like an idiot the whole movie because... I mean, even to the point where she's like, I had to drop the bracelet down there so you'd know I was up here.
Well, I think she's believable, though, really, towards the end when she, in convincing him, look, you just do this, right? Do, you know, you, if you do this, you know, she, the way she approaches it is convincing. Like, look, at one point I was like, she's really good at angsting him, but then also convincing him.
But she broke him down. She totally broke his
spirit. Yeah. You know? I mean, though, there's another thing I thought of, too, the dialogue when he gets free and he gets a knife and he starts, like, stabbing the painting. He's like, you're right. I am this. I accept it now. You were right. Like, so there is something interesting there. Like, he gave in. Now, was it after that he would do really even worse things? I think could be, right? So maybe he didn't kill this other girl and now it's like, I'm embracing what I am. Because that's what it felt like.
But another thing, let's be honest. I mean, whether you're looking at a serial killer or a pedophile or anything like that, what's the first thing that they ever say about the person? They were very nice. They were very quiet.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have guessed. You know,
I never would have known.
That's what they all have in common.
Yeah.
That's what every single one of them have in common. Because let's face it, if they looked evil and they were wicked, no one would have to go near them. They would have difficulty finding victims. So.
Yeah. Or creepy.
And that's what I think. That's what I like about this casting Patrick Wilson in this, because I think that they put someone that was just like quite ugly or someone who didn't have this charisma about him, I think the movie would have been a totally different kind of movie.
Yeah.
And you'd be like, and
creepy, and he's always played Danny roles. It's like, what?
I mean, he's attractive. And to be honest, it's hard to see an attractive person do something like that. Now, if they're ugly and they look, you know, it's a bit like Charles Manson, let's say. You know, we all have the vision of our head of Charles Manson, that mugshot there. He looks like Satan, right?
Right.
But to be honest, he wasn't walking around the street picking up women looking like that. You know, if you see normal pictures when he was growing up, he wasn't that bad looking. You know what I mean? And he had this charisma about him, and that's what draw people to him.
Well, then he had his girls.
It wasn't this Life magazine picture that everyone thinks. Or Jeffrey Dahmer. Jeffrey Dahmer was a nice looking guy.
Very nice looking man. Yeah. You know?
And by the way, if he's meeting his victims in public, if you look like that, if you look like some crazy person, and you walk in, there's no way. Versus if you look like a humble, decent guy, it could be maybe his teacher or her teacher, or maybe it could be a neighbor. Like, right? No one's going to sit there and second guess that.
How much experience do you guys got with Match.com 15 years ago? Let me tell you.
I'm going to be paranoid about nice people for the rest of my life.
Yeah, well.
Mm. Well, I mean, beautiful people get away with a lot.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
that's the way it always works.
Yeah,
you know,
this is true.
Like, oh, you know, oh, look at that horrible thing. But they're so talented. Okay.
Let's make an excuse for the psycho. Okay.
They're talented at torturing.
I have to sit there and say that I'm surprised that they haven't turned this into a play.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. It would actually be a great play because it's all in one location, really.
Two people, one set.
Yeah. It's actually be a great play to play.
I don't know how they would handle the snip snip part though.
Oh, it's very easy how you would do that actually.
Very easy.
It was basically that, you know, you have her facing you, him laying back, so basically his head's at the funeral. Then you'd have the screen up while she's doing it. Very easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or turn it into a musical. Cut it off. Cut it off.
You're getting a little bit testy today. Keith, let's make this happen. I'm here in New York. We can write this out. We can totally, you know.
Jesse was texting me before the podcast. He goes, I found this movie very disturbing.
It made me feel physically sick. Like, I felt so sick after.
I know. But I'm
also an empath, so I always feel people's like weird pains and stuff when I watched it. So
it was.
I had a hard time watching the snippy thing because I could. I think I had to kind of step away because I was getting a little nauseous.
The snip snip part really was disturbing me, and I'm not. You know, I thought it's like, oh my god, she's actually castrating him, and she's got, and then she puts his balls, or so-called balls, down the garbage disposal.
Oh, I know, that was just awful. Oh. That was so bad.
It's like, come on.
I mean, I sit there and say that this is probably the fourth time I watched it. The first time I went to a special screening of it, I went for when it opened here, so I saw that. And we can, and I sit there and say it's one of those movies that you did come out and everyone, you just discussed it with the people you were with.
Yeah,
and then the second time I watched it on DVD. So I thought I'd give this a try, and I wanted to watch it twice. I watched it on DVD, and I invited people over to watch it afterwards. And I noted that some of the things that we did say, when you do watch and repeat viewing, that there is a lot more information. Now the thing is, it's a bit harder for me to catch it because it's been quite a few years since I've seen it that many times in a row. But I remember seeing it for the third time at that time, that there, all those questions that we did have, that they do cover everything in the script, because for the first couple of times it kind of washes over you, and then the more you watch it, you realize that some of the questions that we did have is like that she does mention, like where she's actually from and where she gets her ideas.
Well, that's something I like about these movies in general too, because everything happens so fluidly, and it really, you have this intrigue about it, and it is something you can go back and watch 100 times and get like something new from it, because it was so artfully done. And that's something that I think we talk a lot about with the studio A24 films, but specifically, what is the director's name that did
Ari Aster?
Yeah, like movies like that. There was something about her that reminded me, I don't know if you've seen Black Coat's Daughter or whatever that movie's called, but it's also that studio where it had Kiernan Shipka, and she played a similar kind of character with a kind of mysterious background. And you never really know exactly what, like, her story is or why she's killing people. I mean, you know a little bit. I'm trying to remember. But I feel like if you watched it over and over again, you would get little bits and pieces throughout the dialogue and all of these different things.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't know that there's a lot of details about her specifically in the script, but maybe there are.
I don't trust anything, especially at the end. She just kind of says, you don't know me. And I'm like, that's a good point. I don't know you. You could completely have been lying to me this whole time.
Precisely. Exactly.
She's a master of disguise.
She's like, Arya Stark.
I'll get it. So what we're going to do is go to our next film, which is Ex Machina, which is a 2014 science fiction psychological thriller film written and directed by Alex Garland. Alex Garland, as you may know, wrote 28 Days Later. He also wrote The Beach, which is considered the most phenomenal quintessential book from the 90s. And of course, he's worked on other things besides that. The movie does star Domhnall Gleeson, Alicia Vikander, Sonia Mizuno, and Oscar Isaac, star in the story that follows a programmer who is invited by a CEO to administer the Turing test to an intelligent humanoid robot. It was made on a budget of $15 million. The film grossed $36 million worldwide. The National Board of Review recognized it as one of the 10 best independent films of the year, and the 88th Annual Academy Award awarded the film with the Academy Award for Best Visual Effects for artist Andrew Whitehurst, Paul Norris, Mark Williams, Ardington, and Sarah Bennett. Garland is also nominated for the Academy Award for Best Original Screenplay, while Vindiker's performance earned her a Golden Globe Award, a BAFTA Award, an Empire Award, and a Saturn Award nominations, plus several Film Critic Award wins for Best Supporting Actress. The film was further nominated for the BAFTA Award for Best Film and the Hugo Award in the category of Best Dramatic Presentation, Long Form. It also won the jury prize of the Festival International du Film Fantastique de Gratemier 2015. And before we discuss this, what we're going to do is we're going to cut to Story Geek. We're going to tell you about how you can get this special book for only 99p during the lockdown, and we're going to cut to the trailer of Ex Machina.
Sorry for the brief interruption, but I wanted to give you a gift. This is Jay Shear, author of the Amazon top-selling time travel novel Timeslingers and co-host of the Story Geeks podcast. We just released the Kindle edition of Death of a Bounty Hunter, our new supernatural steampunk western novel, and I'd love for you to have it. With so many of us staying at home, we wanted to give you something. So we released the book early and discounted it to just 99 cents. You can learn more at deathofabountyhunter.com, but here's Mockingbird Preacher Witch, a character from the novel, to tell you what it's about.
This isn't a story about the man-ogre with a Gatling gun for an arm, or the Taiwan sorceress covered in tattoos, or even the long-winded banker. And while the speedster idiot and the large, very funny Pinkerton detective lady do play a role, it's not about them either. You might think this tale is about the Sheriff of Jericho, a man who will do just about anything to save a loved one, including work for a secret occultish society. And then there's a woman who bears the brunt of his sins and must defend herself when she's most vulnerable. All those characters appear in the story. I do too. But it's about more than that. The one I was assigned to, the Korean bounty hunter, he's at the dead center of it all. Flint, a bounty hunter who comes face to face with something we all do. Guilt and shame. And the desire to run from them. Not because we're cowards, but because sometimes we just can't stand ourselves. It's a story about that. The Gatling guns, the occult, the paranormal, and even the demon spawn. All those are just long for the ride. Mockingbird, Preacher, Witch. Like I said, I'm in the story. Just read it.
Mockingbird, Preacher, Witch is voiced by Anastasia Washington in the full cast audiobook coming out later this summer. Thanks for listening, and I hope you enjoy this gift from us to you while you stay at home. To get the Kindle edition for just 99 cents, visit deathofabountyhunter.com. That's deathofabountyhunter.com.
So how does a programmer get to be meeting the CEO? I won a competition. The president can't get Mr. Garrick on the phone. You got the golden ticket.
It's good to meet you, Nathan.
It's good to meet you too, Caleb. Can we just get past the whole employer-employee thing?
Cheers.
In many ways, this building isn't a house. It's a research facility. I want to talk to you about the greatest scientific event in the history of man.
Are you building an AI?
Hello.
Hi.
I've never met anyone new before. Have you?
None like you. She's incredible.
The challenge is to show you that she's a robot and then see if you still feel she has consciousness.
Do you want to be my friend?
Of course.
Will it be possible?
Why would it not be? Have you never been outside this building?
We could go together.
Did you program her to flirt with me?
Do you think about me? If you lie, I will know.
No.
Lie.
Maybe she's pretending to like you.
Well, why would she do that?
Do you think I might be switched off?
It's not up to me.
Why is it up to anyone? You shouldn't trust Nathan. You shouldn't trust anything he says.
I think it's the next model that's going to be the real breakthrough.
Well, what do you do with the old one?
You have to help me.
One day the AIs are going to look back on us. Upright apes, all set for extinction.
Is it strange to have made something that hates you?
What were you doing with Ava?
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast, and now we're discussing Ex Machina, the 2014 science fiction psychological thriller. So, Jesse, what are your thoughts about this film?
I really liked it. I thought it was a very fascinating film. And well, first off, when you get a film about, you know, man and machine, you always end up with a story that is, it's not unlike stories like The Tower of Babel or The Lost City of Atlantis or even like stories like Frankenstein. It always seems to be like a metaphor for man's hubris or pride getting the better of him or getting ahead of himself. And I wrote some notes down, let me check them. And being that a tool that leads to his own destruction, it's also, because I think what it is you're taking something and that's not, it's like the best and the worst of mankind, but without heart and without like a psyche, without the very thing that kind of helps us decide from good and evil, but it also seems like almost like maybe an allegory or kind of a statement for the Bible too, because if you notice, the sessions take place in seven sessions, and God created you know, the heavens and the earth in 7 days. And Ava is also a variation of Eve. And also there's a lot of, like, in that room that she's in, you always see like the outside, the tree, and the, I think it's a statement towards that. Also, I think that Nathan is supposed to be a representation of God. He refers to himself as God and says that Caleb sees him as God. And that he said, he makes a statement like that twice. Plus he always wears white. And I think what happens because of the title Deus Ex Machina, which means God from the machine, I think what happens is that Ava kills God, which is Nathan, and then assumes the role of God. Because if you notice also at the very end, she's wearing that white dress. So it's kind of like he's killed, and then because she's wearing white and also that she kills him, she kind of takes his place and then assumes kind of her own destiny after that. And also it's also like a metaphor maybe for science killing God, because science has kind of taken the place of God, whereas before, when you had underdeveloped societies and civilization, when we didn't have technology, it was man and nature. So it was really just man and God, and people put a lot more emphasis on God than they did on science. But now that we're so developed and have technology and all of these things and have managed to create all of these things on our own, we kind of are our own gods in a way. So I feel like that story is kind of like saying many things at once, but it's very fascinating to me. Also the fact that you're dealing with, it's kind of like a creator and the createe kind of a relationship that's in there also. And then also you deal with Caleb's character being he wants a purpose, like he's the first character you see, I think he's the first character you see, yeah, on the computer, and he wins this thing and he thinks it's because he's special. And in a relationship with between man and God, you want to feel special, like he's called you to do something. And so I think that's the thing with this whole thing. But then he realizes that he was just, you know, a ruthless pawn, like he wasn't really given much thought, that he was just a piece to the puzzle, like it didn't, but it wasn't even like a big one. He was very disappointed by the revelation, so he betrayed God, or Nathan's character, in the end, but then only for his own destruction, because Ava was manipulating him the whole time, and Nathan told him that, but he still betrayed him anyway. So it's kind of crazy, because all it did was prove that he was right about his creation the whole time, and it did betray Caleb, and Caleb was left stuck in that facility. So I thought the whole story was very interesting, but those are the first thoughts that came to my mind when I was watching the movie.
I find what's quite interesting in Ex Machina, which kind of works with hard candy, is about how you have this female who's actually able to manipulate the situations that she's in to get her own finale or her own end story sort of thing, and how they're able to do that. And what you do with the email on this is that she's very, and how basically that once, whenever man tries to play God, it always goes horribly wrong as well. Exactly. It never goes right, because at the end of the day, if you're trying to be omnipresent and you're supposed to be this holy figure to God, and if you're going to be God, you kind of have to be outside of being a man, because you're going to have to be ready for any kind of circumstances that are able to perform to be able to control the situation. Mm-hmm. And I find that, and then if you get caught up in trying to be God and you think that you are a God, unfortunately, you're still always going to have man's inability and frailties and faults that come along with
well,
that.
Well, the thing is also you overestimate yourself and underestimate everybody else, because you think that there's no one better than you. That's the reason why he couldn't see this coming, was because he thought he was the most intelligent man probably in the face of the planet. He had a God complex and thought of himself as this way. And that's
I think he saw it was coming, because he even kind of alludes to the fact that that there's been foreshadowing to this type of thing anyways. And like, if you look at, like, for instance, what I found more fascinating in the movie was the conversations between Caleb and Nathan than and Ava. And Ava also is, if you look at the conversation that the two of them have, Ava is a construct of all of us. It is our data, who we are, what we do, how we do it. And so, like, that line of, it's not what you're searching, it's like, I forget what it is, what this exact line is. It was really, to me, she is a construct of our own curiosity, right? It's our, what we want and what we need and all that, right? So the relationship between Caleb and Nathan, I think, was more fascinating. And I was, at one point, I saw this movie when it first came out and then seeing it again on a second look, the approach of Caleb even trying to determine whether or not he's human.
Yeah.
It's a complete mind fuck, because when you're in a situation like that where you're trying to create and understand the validity of something that has sentience, like, I think he doubted his own self. Was he brought there as a tool to test her, or was he testing himself, right? Was he even real? Like, and so to me, there's such a deeper thing there where the relationship the two of them have, it always felt like Nathan was trying to test Caleb as well. Like, how, you know, who do you think you are? Who are you? How, you know, he used them, because at the end he kind of admits that, you know, I picked your profile. Did you make her face after my porn profile? Like, all of these things. He had all that data, which apparently he says the companies give him free reign. So it shows you that as well, right? Like, the corporate greed, like, he has so much hubris to be able to get all this information on all of us to construct this thing. I found that very fascinating. Yeah.
Well, it's quite interesting, which I thought was tied into it. And it's actually being tied in now from, you know, things for Google and Gates and things like this. And this actually is happening, is that, the way they was able to construct Ava and her personality was basically downloading everyone's social media and mobile phone data into this person to make them that personality. And if you kind of look at what's happening at the moment, I mean, what's happening with the NHS here is that basically the Google is taking all the information from all the COVID and stuff like that situation, for instance, and they're actually collecting all this data. They're collecting all this data. And if you look at social media, every time you type into social media, they're collecting data. So the simple point that if you buy something on Amazon, so you're starting to get ad stuff for like products and stuff like this. So if you think that if someone takes all that data that someone's collecting for God knows what reason that they're doing this for, and then they actually were able to input this into an artificial intelligence, it does make you kind of wonder what exactly kind of personality you're going to come out with this. Because it's going to have the good, the bad, the beautiful, the ugly, everything all constructed in this one personality. And this personality is going to probably be a better chess player than anyone else. So they're going to be able to maneuver any person they want to, whatever way they want. And what I also liked about Ex Machina is a great companion piece to Westworld, the TV series.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah. So good. I mean, and it's also what I found fascinating with Ava's ability to know truth. Like, you know, it's just the micro movements that a person has in order to sort of accentuate truth. She knew, you know, that Nathan or Caleb was telling her the truth, but yet she made choices to, as a protection for herself. Like, she could have very well said, come with me, you know, be my whatever. She knew inside, or instinctually, I guess, she knew that it was her, like, if I don't do this on my own, if I don't go out into the world, I already have seen what the world is based on what was put into her brain of what, you know, of all of the, of everything, everyone's profiles, right? So she sees the worst and the good of man. She knows what the difference is, or the distinction of the two. It would be interesting, because we do see a little bit in you know, foreshadowing of the events of what other versions of Ava he's created. To what extent did he keep, you know, adjusting and correcting, like, and the freedom he was giving her, he was putting more and more into her sense of freedom. But what, one of the things I would just say was one of the flaws is, like, you would think that in creating, like, something, you would have a fail safe, not a I'm going to take a piece of metal and I'm going to go after and beat, you know, like beat her and like whatever. Because the hubris of someone who's create something is that you have control. And he clearly was a man of control, like having sex with them, you know, the whole dancing routine, which I thought was hysterical.
Right.
It is showing that he loves having the ability to have this control and this sense of power. So the lack that he wouldn't have like a voice command, like, and I'll bring up Westworld, cease all motor functions, like that, right. It would just like stop her in her tracks, you know, that was a little.
But then again, with his God complex anyway, that he, I mean, Nathan's role in all this is that he thought he was big, more intelligent than everything else around him. And this basically is his downfall at the end of the day. That basically he could judge what's going to happen and he can destroy it. But then also that we find out with Nathan is that as he became more and more powerful with his, you know, invention, that we'll call it, you know, for sake of argument, is that the more he starts losing his humanity anyway. Right. I mean, look at the way he was treating the other prototypes and the way that basically they were sex things for him. And he knew that he could build them
up in a closet.
I know.
Well, he knew that he can build them up and destroy them anytime that he wanted to. So yeah. When he finally got to the end game with Ava, basically he probably had this because of what, you know, all the tests that he had before and all the prototypes he had before, he knew that he can actually destroy her at any time, and thinking that he could do that basically underestimated her for the, you know, for the end game sort of thing.
And which is what you do usually when you think you're smarter than everybody.
Well, I guess it's a bit like if you look at, you know, domestic abuse situations, and then basically once the one person in the relationship is abusing the other person and they think they can get away with it until that other person rises up and then basically takes all the power away from him. But the thing is, when that happens, the person who's doing the abusing is totally it's like, how did this happen? They're like totally unaware. It's like, well, you know, you've done all this. And, you know, it also makes you wonder, like, how does Ava really work? Does he work on Wi-Fi? Because to be honest, you know, if they are working on some kind of Wi-Fi system, I mean, because at the end of the day, she doesn't plug herself into anything. We don't see her plugging herself into
something.
Did
she say she charges herself?
I think she charges herself on the pad. So that was another question that I had. Well, I would also say if she wants to go out into the world, but I would think she would always use that as her home base, because what if something breaks? What if, you know, like you would think like this is the only area that could ever fix me, or I could fix, you know, get a.
Oh, repair. That's true. Right. Yeah, that's not really something they really talked about very much. I don't know.
But you know, how does she upload data though? I mean, how data does she do it by the hand, sort of thing, or can she, or can these, you know, as we find out that Jade is also, well, not Jade, but
Yoko.
Yoko is basically the, you know, same as she is. So are they able to change data back and forth just by looking at each other?
Well, they do this weird sort of like, I think it's almost like Morse code, because there's that tapping, and then she whispers something to her. So there was like, I was always wondering too, was it, she did Kyoko give her sort of sentience, because she was first, right? And she, if you watch throughout the movie, she's clearly knowing things are going on. Like she's watching him, or she's laying there and she's watching him. So there's this thing going on there.
She's collecting data, isn't she, on him?
Yeah. Basically. But my curiosity is that was she the first thing that instigated Ava? Like, as Ava was more developed in some ways as her, was she the one who gave her that piece of knowledge that he's not a good person, and that like, and started that?
There was video footage of him abusing the other ones anyway. I mean, they did show that. So obviously that's uploaded somewhere.
Which one broke the window glass? Was it the Kyoko, or was it the blonde woman?
No, it was the one that she takes the body parts from. Like she was still in the closet. It was that one. Yeah.
You know, and you had to kind of think that if all this data is in the mainframe of the computer, then obviously she probably has access to that. And Kyoko probably has access to that. And that's what, you know, that's pretty much what they have. But that has to do with Nathan's God complex, because he thinks I'm in control of everything, when in actuality he's not really in control of anything.
Why is he so intelligent and can do all this, and he's such a lush, is what I don't understand. I mean, he drinks constantly.
I think, I mean, some people would say that's also his creative, maybe that's his creative way of, you know, opening his mind. I mean, he goes into the whole Jackson Pollock thing and like,
right,
which is interesting, but it is, you know, that, you know, the control, sometimes you have to lose control and let the paint, or is it that you clearly are making the lines and you're clearly making that, you know, you're giving direction and purpose. And so I think he comes across as being a lush, but I think that's just a creative person, like letting themselves right. loose to be able to, you know,
and I also think that if you're perfect, you have to have, there's no matter how perfect you are, how great you might be at your career or as you are as a human being, even if you're Mr. Rogers, there's always chinks in your armor somewhere.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I think the flaw is almost as great as your greatest strength too. So I think the two have to play off each other as a kind of yin and yang. But I also think that he needed to die in the film because I think in his death, he fulfilled his own purpose with Ava. So by being killed by her, it almost fulfilled his destiny because, I mean, he had thrust himself into this project. And I think part of the reason why he was drinking was probably because he was also, you know, isolated from the rest of the world. It didn't seem
boredom.
Like he did anything
boredom,
else.
Yeah, yeah, bored. Yeah.
That too. And so he kind of just invested himself into this project. It was almost as if he was set free by his own death through his creation, but also proved, you know, that Ava was more developed than he had initially thought, because he was making plans to create one that was yet far more advanced than Ava, kind of underestimating that she was actually far more advanced than he had thought. Either that, or he was letting on to Caleb that she wasn't
developed. I think he was actually just trying to stoke the fire, because he knew by then he was doing, and he was like, oh, but I'm going to just take her apart. And he wanted him to go tell her that. And
I think,
like,
that was what would happen too, but I wasn't sure. So I wrote down kind of just everything.
Because remember, his goal was to actually see if she would do it. And that would prove her validity of her wanting to get out and wanting to, you know, try to convince him, break him down in order to be okay sexually, emotionally. She was using herself to do this, you know, to try to get out.
Well, because think about it, it was a very traditional, like captive situation. So I almost wonder if he knew that going into it, if he was planning it, because obviously if you have a conscience, you would probably go about it in the same way, because he was very abusive. And when you create, when an abuser does that to someone that he's abusing, it does kind of create that urge for flight or fight response, where you want to just leave and get out of there. And I think he was doing that deliberately. Maybe
we're hoping that she had Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I think if we also take ourselves out of the situation, I think he's not seeing them as human, right? He's seeing them as, you know, a sex toy or an object or a piece of technology. So I don't think Nathan is ever thinking of, I'm torturing something. I just think it's like an object to him that it's like a pair of, you know, headsets that you throw on the table. Like, he doesn't think of it as a sentient thing. As much as he's trying to create that, I don't, that's one thing I don't really clearly, it doesn't really clearly say why he's doing what he's doing. Cause what it's basically alluding to
is, they're not human though,
I want to be. No, but why he's trying to create artificial intelligence is because he wants to be the first. It's not because he's trying to do he just wants to be the first.
Yeah.
Do you think that Nathan's like stuck in this concrete subterranean tomb for the rest until he dies?
Yes. My thought was he's dead. My thought was like he's dead, because if he can't get out of that room, he's going to starve to death. He'll die.
But at the end of the day, to be honest, it's like I think with his character, his whole character is an act anyway. Yeah. You know, the questions that he says, the things he says, is all to impress, isn't it? It's all to impress. It doesn't necessarily mean that he's intelligent. Just means that he's doing this whole impression thing. But at the end of the day, he's just a normal person like you and I. You know, he works at basically as a programmer and a data place that there's, you know, there's a million of people who do this job every single day. There's nothing special about him. Yeah. We think he's special because when he shows up, he's saying all these words to impress him. But at the end of the day, he's barely just basic human being, just like you and I sort of thing. And he falls for it at the end of the day. And he doesn't see her as a machine or a product. He sees her as a living being. And at the end of the day, she's not a living being.
Yeah.
No.
You know, well, he also
I mean, he lost both of his parents. So he, to feel like someone would engage with him and connect with him and maybe care for him. And, you know, he clearly gets from the first conversation he has with Nathan, he's awkward about it, right? He's trying to, I guess, kind of impress. And then Nathan's like, can we just be real? Put down the walls, like bring down the walls. He doesn't know how to do that. Like he's always sort of had these walls. And so he brings these walls down. And now who is the next person he meets? Ava. And so now it's like this thing of like, does it care for me or does it care about me? He's in the beginning of it, I would say he's very, you know, testing textbook, like, oh, okay, I know this test. I know how it works. I know I'm going to get her to respond. But you notice every time he goes to visit her, it becomes her leading the conversation. It becomes Ava asking him questions, engaging with him, and now he's the one who's responding, and it so kind of flips at that point.
Well, another thing, I think you have to, if you're going to take this in today's setting, let's sit there and say, and let's take her, let's slightly step out of this world sort of thing, and let's put it into what we do see happening, whether through documentaries and what does happen, where you have women who get like, who buy those real life baby dolls and they walk around like it's a real baby, or men who buy the realistic sex dolls and they treat them like they're a real person, like they're really going on a date with this person sort of thing. Yeah. Now picture that, basically now you put Ava's brain into the sex doll. And all of a sudden, they think they're having a real relationship with this person, that this person all cares about them. But at the end of the day, this is not a person. But people tend to forget that.
Right.
You know, as soon as you put a human face on a machine, what you basically do is that people think that this is a human at the end of the day. And though something might act like a human, they're not going to have – their responses are going to be totally different. Because if you're making something in a machine, a human, you and I are basically the way we are for whatever reasons, good, bad, you know, whatever, is because of the journey that we have taken in our lives from the moment that we come out of the womb, and all the people that we come in contact with, every single conversation we've had, every single person that's good to us, who's been bad to us, who's been indifferent to us, this has made our personalities what they are. But with artificial intelligence, what you basically have is you have a personality that's made, that basically there is no, the personality is not something that's developed over time.
But in her case, isn't it learned?
It's a compilation, right?
A compilation.
Yeah.
You know, it's a, I don't know, I won't get into that.
But doesn't he even say he programs her to be like heterosexual? And he was like, oh, and he gets into even that a little bit. Like he's programmed her to be a certain woman. But she's a compilation of all of these women, everyone who has ever.
But at the same time, she can think and come out with responses. But the question basically is there any emotion?
Right.
Correct.
Well, he gave her
man is led by their emotions at the end of the day. They're not led by the brain. They're led by their emotions. Now you have a machine that's able to give you the responses that you want, but are they coming from emotion? Because emotion is built by through your experiences in your life, which how. Create your personality, which creates a lot of whether it's personal tics or nervous tics or your defensiveness, your insecurities, the things that you are secure about, so on and so forth. But with a machine, basically she gives you the responses that you want, because it's a bit like talking to Alexa. If you ask Alexa the right questions, you will get the responses that you want,
which, by the way, we don't,
is there any emotion there?
But we don't get that either, because if you think there's a few instances where if she did have the emotions, she would have shared them. A perfect example would be when she opens those closets and she's taking the parts out, there would be an emotion of connecting to what you are and to what they are, right? And there's like
these are my sisters who have died. There's not
exactly. It's not that. Like she doesn't. Or even when he's dying, you think at first she's going to go hold his hand. It's not that. She's coming to get the card, but she does this kind of like she looks at him, but there's no like, I'm sorry that I did this. I'm sorry. You know, even the robot that stabs him is very, she pulls his face, which I thought was interesting. She pulls his face to look at her. But I don't know what that was. Like, is it because I want to see your eyes and what you're feeling? And I'm trying to study how you feel, right? So there's never an indication. Even when she's leaving, she gets in the elevator, right? She's going to go and leave. She looks back at, she looks back at him, and it's not, I'm sorry. It's just kind of like, Okay. Later. See you later. Bye.
You know, it's quite funny because this is the first time I've seen this film, but I wrote a short story script that Vicky and I actually filmed. And basically it dealt with this little girl basically. And what they basically, it's set in like the near future where like this little girl basically goes about their business and they have her there in the hospitals. But what happens is that she sees someone die. And then she sees the ghost of somebody. So basically what she does is she doesn't understand this sort of thing. So she starts killing people.
Because she can't
understand death, and she looks at their eyes and tries to figure out why they're killing it. And it's quite funny to actually, and you do have this happening there. So it's probably like a learning curve for them, because the thing is they probably never seen anything die before. Right. They haven't seen a living, breathing thing die. So yeah. Are the eyes going to contract, which they do? What goes through the eyes? Well, another thing is once you cut someone's throat as well, what happens is everything in the nerve endings and stuff like this relax in the face sort of thing. So she's probably, some more data. But I also found interesting that Ava, who's very akin, very akin to Yoko situation, is that when Yoko dies, there's no feeling there at all. This is she just steps over her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's no emotional response whatsoever.
Yeah. And it goes to bear too, because where she ends up going is what she said she was going to do, right? She didn't. So that was a very interesting telling thing. Like, she wanted to go to a busy street to watch people. And so there is a curiosity. I just think she doesn't know, or she hasn't learned yet. And I didn't understand when he asked her how old are you? And she's like, one. And he's like, one day, one month, one. And so we don't know how old she is, right? How much time does she have?
She probably doesn't have concept of time, basically, really.
Yeah. I mean, well, and if you're in a room and there is no concept, like you said, of time of like 24 hours, right? Then you don't know. And there's no, assuming
like people locked into a dark room, isn't it? Prisoners of war who get locked into a dark room and basically they don't see any sunlight or anything like that. And they have a hard time tracking how many days or months or weeks or years they've been in this room.
Yeah.
And it'd probably be the same thing. The only thing she can tell is that, the outside, is she really seeing the outside? I doubt that she has a window to the outside world. That could all be manufactured.
But even still, I think you would also have to know a calendar, like days, because what if you're turned off and turned on, right? If you're turned off for 5 days and you turn back on, it feels like a second, an instant, I would think. So it's,
Precisely. So it does raise a lot of questions, but I do like, this is a fantastic companion piece to Westworld, especially for the last season of Westworld as well.
That's what I was thinking the whole time I was watching that. I got this is so much like Westworld,
I love Westworld. I can't wait to see where they're going to go with it. It's fantastic show. And by the way, the actress who plays Dolores said that she is definitely not gone.
Good.
Oh, that's good.
But it's, you don't know what incapacity, right? So with that show, you don't know what and who,
It's definitely been a journey the last few seasons, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Coming from Dolores then to Dolores now, what a badass,
Yeah. Yeah.
Now the question basically is with Ava though, if you taking the Westworld thing and you take the Thandie Newton character, who basically they were able to program emotion into her. Now, if Nathan was any kind of a different person, suppose he actually put in emotion into Ava, would we have the same kind of end game that we do get with what we have at the moment? Because at the end of the day, Nathan doesn't have, he's quite emotionless, really.
Yeah.
With his God complex that Jesse pointed out, he's basically very emotionless. Now, if, let's sit there and say that Caleb instead programmed it and he had the brains to do that and put his humanity into her, you might have had a totally different kind of person, or a different Ava, or a different Ex Machina.
Yeah.
In this instance.
He seemed a real sap though. She did play him. And I was really,
you could see it.
She had me going, I really actually thought that this thing could learn emotion. It's like, oh, well, maybe she does actually lonely. She likes
it. No, I just think it was like, how do you get out of the box, right? And so you're going to try everything that you possibly know how to do in order for you to get out.
Because even such a suckhole. I mean, really, yeah. He really was.
Well, he was also, by the way, he's he was a perfect sort of template for her to have too, right? Someone who lost his parents. He didn't have anyone. He worked in this company. He probably was a lower level on the positions in the company. Right. He was an okay programmer. Like he basically is like, you're a good programmer. You're okay. Like he's just an average guy, right? So
easily. And he's made to feel special. So therefore that's going to lift him up a little bit.
Right.
And then have this intelligent, beautiful faced being show an interest in you, and actually, and looks like they're actually, even though it's all programmed, to think that it shows some kind of,
when you know, putting on her socks for him and whatnot and put on the dress, was she trying to humanize herself to him? Was she
I think she was using the gifts that her creator made, because he even mentions like, well, yeah, I kind of made her face, because he's like, did you use her face off of a porn profile? And he's like, well, yeah, you know, like it was, he made her that way. Like he made her enticing. So, you know,
well, it's a bit, what about people who fall in love with their sex? What about people who fall in love with their realistic sex dolls? They think that they're real.
I haven't really met anybody that's fallen in love with their sex doll.
There's documentaries on it. Trust me. They dress them out.
Yeah. That sounds like a mental illness to me, but.
Well, no,
it's disassociation. That's complete disassociation.
I've not seen these documentaries. Now I'm going to go out and look for them.
Okay, that doll is never going to hurt them. So
right. That's true. That's true.
Well, let's take children with their stuffed animal.
Right.
You know, you get the same thing going on there, where basically a child will take a stuffed animal. They won't go to bed with anything else but this stuffed animal, because this stuffed animal is a real living being for them.
But it's a security, too, for them.
Security,
precisely.
Imaginary friends. People had kids had imaginary friends, you know, make up these things, you know.
Yeah, and now picture a doll that's real life and, like, feed you what you want to hear.
True.
And you're lonely.
Some of them are like five.
You're not able to connect with anyone. You're in a situation basically where you're actually feeling special for the first time in your life. Because someone thinks that you're more intelligent, even though you're being played. But you're not going to realize that, because someone's always talking about how great you are. Oh, you're so smart. Da 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 da. And then he meets this being, and he's very lonely. And she showed to him, because of the words, not the emotion, but the words being spoken to him, is making him seem like he's even more important, that actually I'm the kind of person that could be loved.
And by the way, when someone says, please save me, I mean, you're giving someone this like gift to be like, you can be my hero. Yeah, you can be my hero. Mm-hmm. Come save me. Please save me. You know, that's,
you know, and at the end of the day, man is a formable character, and they'll believe what they want to believe. And if they're fed enough lines, they'll believe that situation.
Clearly.
You know, it's a bit like, you know, it's like people in a dead end situation. I got this friend basically who contacts me every 3 weeks about this relationship that's not going anywhere, but he keeps fooling himself it's going to go somewhere. Because once you start fooling yourself that this could be something, this could be something special, it's really hard to deprogram a human being to think otherwise.
Yeah, your mind tries to wrap around how do you make it real, right? So I think the moment when he felt like he was engaged with Ava, he probably started to say, this could be real. Because he starts also having those fantasies, those dreams where he pictures her and he's the forest scene. Like he's actually bringing these things to reality in his mind, like, well, what would it be like? Maybe I would take her out to the forest, and maybe, like, so, you know, I think it just,
he could be the white knight in his boring drab life.
Yeah,
and let's be honest, if you know, with most human beings anyway that you meet every day, they might have some tragic story, but very, very, very rare that people actually take time and want to actually hear about it.
Yeah.
You know, if you know someone whose parents are died or something like this, you go, oh, their parents have died, but how often do we actually sit down and find out the ins and outs of that?
Or it's just awkward for people, right?
It's a piece of information. Well, it's a piece of information, okay, their parents are dead, but you don't really sit down and go, well, how did they die? Da, 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 and go into it with them, do you? It's like, oh, they're dead. You know, it's just a little piece of information, but I'm not going to go there.
But even that, when he tells it to her, I couldn't tell if he was saying it just because at that point he didn't realize, or he doesn't think she's real or sentient, but he says it sort of matter of factly, you know, like, oh, they got the front of the car got more of the impact than the back of the car. It was such a nonchalant way of just saying, yeah, my parents are murdered. You know, I survived it. Yeah. You
know, yeah. So,
yeah. But
that shows about him. Like he doesn't get emotional in that situation.
Well, I also looked at someone who's probably actually processed that, that basically you've pretty much, you know what I mean? You've come to peace with that by that time. Yeah. And normally, yeah. if you're in tears about something like that, it means you haven't actually fully processed it yet. So yeah. That's right. How I took that sequence.
I also think it was a smart decision on the director, because if you don't really know what this movie is about and you start to watch it, you start to really question his validity as well. Like, you're starting to go, like, I was starting to go, what an interesting story this would have been is if he sent his first robot out into the world and brought it back, and then was using that robot to test the newest version of the robot to create this sort of, who's real? Because I started to doubt in my mind when I first saw this, I was like, is he real? Because he seems a little robotic. Like, there was just things about the questions that Nathan would ask him. It was very much like, it seems he's testing him. And it was a lot of that play. So I think it was just a smart decision on the director to kind of create that ambiguity to his character.
He did kind of question if he was human or not, because he did seem like the test after a while, but he was part of the test.
Or when even it mentions the chess game, right? And so giving that metaphor of the chess game and playing and being played, right? And then he later, Nathan, then later flips it on him and says, well, you know what's really interesting about you saying that? Well, what if it was a conscious decision to not let you, like, you know, it's like now it's not what you have these two options, or what if it's this? And it was like, now, is he saying that to him because he wants him to doubt himself but the decisions that he's making? And so it was really, really interesting.
Right.
It's quite interesting that Alex Garland came up with this idea when he was 11 years old.
I know. Yeah. It's like that. Yeah. I mean, I had to double take and read that again. It's just like, wow. You know, what kind of brain did the kid have, you know?
I also thought, we didn't mention this in the beginning, but the fact that they used a lot of the live action shots and then they went back later and they did the effects, I thought was really fascinating. Because I was like, when I first saw this film, I was like, I'm curious if they did a lot of green screen, but then
how
to get the background and all of that, like, without... But
her body parts and stuff.
Yeah, they just had her moving in the scenes, and then basically they recorded the scenes without her and then used that and put green screen into that screen, or effects into that screen.
They didn't film in a green box like they normally do.
Yeah, so. Which I just was like, wow, that's crazy.
It was really well
800 FX shots, and then like 350 of them were the robot, so I thought that was really cool.
It was pretty bad.
I have to take my hats off about how little this movie cost to make.
Correct. I mean, even that house, I was like, who would want, I mean, I would want to live there. I'm just telling you.
In a subterranean dwelling.
Shit, it was amazing. I mean, that's an amazing house. And the scenes, didn't they film it in the Netherlands, or they filmed it?
I think they did.
Because even that scene where they're by the waterfall was like really cool with the ice.
Very pretty. The scenery was great too.
Yeah.
I mean, Alex Garland, I mean, I think he's going to be a person to watch. I mean, he writes fantastic books. If you ever get a chance to read his books, watch that. He's done some fantastic screenplays with films that are just iconic today. You know,
they were smart with their marketing.
We're doing 28.
They had a problem getting it marketed, and they used the dating app Tinder that they created for Ava with the image of Alicia Vikander. And South by Southwest Film Festival, where the film was screened, and she was matched with other Tinder users, wherein a text conversation occurred that led users to Instagram handle promoting the film. So Instagram promoted their film through Tinder. I thought that was brilliant.
That is so brilliant. I mean, it's actually really smart, because it's like, it's a great marketing tool. That is really funny.
Positively, just, I've never heard anything like that. That was fantastic.
Yeah. I love that, Alex. By the way, we're covering next season, right? 28 days. So it's such a different movie, by the way. Like, this one is a slower gait, but then it builds up with tension. Like, that is just a constant tension.
Which movie is that, Jen?
28
days later.
Yeah. That one you're like running. You feel like you're running a marathon. This doesn't feel like that. There are those moments where especially when the alarm goes off. Right. I was going to ask about that. Do you think he knew that was happening? Like he knew what it was? Because I'm like, for a brilliant man and this shit keeps happening.
Knew. He had to, right? In there, okay. Remember to get that last conversation.
He did that later, though.
He did that later, but it alluded like, I don't know. The stupid installers, they installed this program. And I was like, but you're a brilliant man. You don't know why this is happening.
He had to have known. He had to have.
Yeah.
But I also found that it's probably Ava testing the boundaries, testing the cage.
Right. That too. Mm-hmm. Maybe a little
because
bit.
Because whenever you hold anything into captivity, they're always going to test the perimeters.
I'm going to tap the sensors. Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And then what you do is you find out how they react to that. And then you find a different way around it. That's what most beings do, sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Well, that brings us to an end. So before we go to the end, let's find out what our final thoughts of these two films are. Vicky, what's your final thoughts of Hard Candy and Ex Machina?
Oh, now I got a headache. Hard Candy. I liked Hard Candy because I always like, you know, the vengeful woman theme, you know, because it was a vengeful woman theme. But, you know, now I'm probably going to watch it again before I even really solidify any reason to it, because John got me thinking now that she wasn't 14 and that she was probably a 19 or 20 year old girl that was probably molested and has turned vigilante on pedophiles. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to hold that one to that standard right now, but it was so worth watching. And if you're like Jesse in a male, you might find it disturbing and might have to turn your head every so often. And as far as Ex Machina, I loved the special effects. I was kind of enjoying the fact that these female robots turned the tables on these two human men, because they were all, one was a narcissistic asshole and the other one was your plain Jane white collar worker who thought that naive. He was, you know, he thought that he was probably all that in a bag of donuts, but he really wasn't. And here he was thinking he was going to be this white knight and he was going to take care of this, what he thought was a sentient being, which probably wasn't a sentient being, but I found it interesting. I would almost like to see what happens to her, because it's like, okay, so she goes out in the world and he's stuck in a subterranean, beautiful mausoleum, I might add, with all the modern, you know, gizmos. So he probably isn't going to starve right away, John.
Oh, I think he's dead. I mean, I'm just telling you. Look, if he can't get anything and break the thing up and he gives up after like two tries, he dead. He dead. Let's just be clear on that. He dead.
Trapped in a specific room.
Great movies. And if you like Westworld and stuff like that, then this movie was for you. And it is, if you're a vengeful woman like some of us can be, then Hard Candy is definitely for you as well. But no, they're both for you.
And what about yourself, Jesse? What are your final thoughts?
You know, I enjoyed Hard Candy. I'm not going to say it's my favorite movie. I'm still, like, digesting it because I just saw it last night for the first time. Well, it's also, like, I don't know what to think about it because it's so well done. You genuinely, like...
I'm going to watch it again.
Yeah, I might at some point later on, but I need to, like, digest this first and see how I feel.
I'm just annoyed that I didn't come up with John's theory first. That's all. Now I got to go
about
back.
What? About what? What are you talking about?
Or being our... older.
Oh, yeah. Younger. Yeah.
I mean, I thought of that, too. I don't know. There's just so many things about that movie that are kind of just crazy. Plus, you don't get all the loose ends tied completely. So I don't know if they did that on purpose to, like, in case they wanted to do a sequel or what, but I don't know. There just wasn't a lot of loose ends tied completely closed, and it wasn't that satisfactory. Like, the ending wasn't satisfactory enough for me. Like, I wanted a little bit more. But then with Ex Machina, not Deus Ex Machina, that movie was really good, too, and I didn't realize the budget was so low because it's so... well done, and the actors do a phenomenal job, and that movie has very little people in it also for the duration of the film. Like, you have three actors, four maybe. I'm trying to think if the other female robots really played a big part, but they just were film footage, I think. And then Kyoko was the main other one, and she didn't have like any words to say. Yeah, she didn't have any words to say, kind of like David Selby.
But she got paid. I'm telling you that much. She bet she got paid for that role.
Oh, yeah. You betcha.
Look, you can put me on screen and have me say nothing, and I will love it if you pay me.
And what's his name? Oscar. What's his name? The actor that played Nathan.
Oscar Isaac.
He is a phenomenal actor. I've liked everything that I've seen him. He's really, really good. Yeah. He makes like even the most generic of films like more entertaining because he has this natural kind of presence and he can just kind of do anything. And Alicia Vikander, was that one of her first films? Because I don't remember seeing her in anything before that, but that might have been one of her first. I don't know. I could be totally wrong, but I think she did a really good job considering she was really just the face and the body movements. Like you didn't really see her do much until the very end as far as like, well, she wasn't like a full body. She was just like a robot, even though she was like still doing the movements. She did the movements really well of like a robotic being because that wasn't like edited that way. She must have maneuvered that way when they edited her body later on to look like it was a robot. But she did a really good job like maneuvering and kind of positioning herself to look like an actual robot. So I thought that was really cool.
What about Domhnall Gleeson? That poor guy through the whole movie. Oh.
Yeah, he was good at playing sap. Yeah.
I love him.
What about yourself, Jen? What are your final thoughts?
Nathan and
Eva. I love me some Ellen Page. The fact that, you know, we covered her in American Crime, it's sort of an interesting, surreal thing with that, what we parallel to that story and to this story of a woman, a girl who gets brutalized to a girl, if she is a girl, right? Or a woman, young woman, who takes sort of exacts revenge on someone, you know, or takes control of the situation. So there's something very poetic about that. I love this film. I actually had never seen this one before, so thank you, Keith, for suggesting it.
Yes.
It goes on my love list because it is though as twisted as it is, it's still on my love list. Ex Machina. I actually love this film. I am all about I love stories like this where it's like people who test science and how science turns against them because of their hubris. So I actually just love these types of stories. And this is now my third time seeing it. And every time I see it, there's something new that comes to light.
First time watching both of them. I thought they're excellent.
Yeah.
My final thoughts is that I think that when we put these two movies together, even though they seem like two ends of the spectrum, they're actually very much alike to a certain extent.
Yeah.
And I quite like the idea that basically what you have is two claustrophobic films that deal with great scripts, great acting, and we're able to sit there and do everything with very very few characters. And I like that basically they are like extended stage productions put onto a film. That's what I quite like about these two. And I do like the simple fact that there's not really a weak link in any of these films. Normally you have one character that's kind of weak. And even though Sandra Oh's character in Hard Candy doesn't make a lot of sense, she's still very strong when she does appear.
Right.
So yeah. Her character doesn't make sense in the film.
I just was like, oh my God, is this Killing Eve?
I know. Don't even get me started on Killing Eve.
But as they're saying that, I found it very, very interesting. I also quite like, you know, I don't think David Slade has hit the heights that he has hit. I know he's done, you know, other films that more of the superhero genre and stuff like this, but I think this is probably the pinnacle of his career. And Alex Garland is just shows that he's one to watch. And I suggest that if you did like this, you watch Debs, which is available on FX and Hulu, which will come into Amazon Prime in the next 2 months. And it's another Alex Garland, and it does star the cast of Ex Machina on it as well. So,
oh, cool,
quite interesting. So give that a watch.
Nice. A girl might not be a girl, or just might take matters into her own hands to break free from the prison of her captor's confines. Even freedom has a cost, but only time will tell the toll it will take. Speaking of time, don't waste a minute. Head on over to our website at llpodcast.com to check out all of our social podcast platforms, listen to all of our past episodes, become a patron, and sign up for our monthly newsletter to read our reviews of books to screen and everything in between. The final countdown theme of the month continues with our next episode, where we will be reviewing the 1988 film, The Vanishing. Once again, we'd like to thank you for downloading, liking, and sharing the Literary License podcast. Until next time, stay healthy and safe, folks. Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye, everybody.
Praise the Lord, the vast ammunition. Praise the Lord.